I can't make on my own. And there are trials I must face all alone. But you said you'd walk with me down life's troubled road. And you said, come unto me.
Sister, that is so true, so true. Let me encourage you from the Bible, give you a verse there, and then we'll get into message this evening. Would you go to Psalms, please? Psalm 42. Psalm 42. We're living in a strange hour. I have a message I'm working on. I haven't gotten together yet. I'm working on, we're living in a different day. And I think about how it was back when I was a teenager, and then I got saved at 19, how it was back then and how it is now. She talked about rivers wider and mountains higher. I'm telling you, there's just a lot of stuff goes on today. Can I get a witness on that? A lot of stuff going on. I was thinking about that, and I was thinking about an email I got. Bear with me here. I'm a little slow with this stuff. Email I got from the NCLL, that National Center for Life and Liberty. It's a law firm that represents Christians. And here's some scenarios they're talking about they have to deal with. Homosexual couples wants to join the church. A Christian parent of a child who claims to be gay or transgender wants to enroll their child in a Christian school. A lesbian applies for a secretary position in a church office. And on and on and on the list goes. Man, we didn't deal with those things years ago. It's just a lot of things. There's just a lot of changes. Things are heating up. Things it seems like, I'm just telling you what the perception, it seems like things are closing in on us spiritually. I'm going to address that tonight. But I want you to notice, before we get into the message, I want you to notice Psalm 42, verse number 11. Psalm 42, verse number 11. The Bible says, "Why art thou cast down, O my soul?" Why is it we look at the news and we go, ah? Oh. Why is it we look around us and it feels like we're just, our things caving in on us. It seems like life is being squeezed out of us because of circumstances. That's what the psalmist says. Why art thou cast down, O my soul? Why art thou disquieted within me? Feel agitated, feel anxiety, feel just the presidential election. Oh, no, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? What are we going to do? And here's the help tonight. Here's the ministry tonight from this verse. Hope thou in God. And tonight, regardless what your situation is or your circumstances are, regardless of how wide that river goes to or how high that mountain gets, tonight we need to remind ourselves our hope is not in another president. Our hope isn't in a raise or a different job or moving out yonder somewhere. Our hope needs to be in the living God of heaven. That's our hope. Hope thou in God, for I shall yet praise Him who is the health of my countenance. It's God that's going to turn the frown to a smile. It's God going to turn that look of weariness into life. Who is the health of my countenance and my God. Let's pray. We'll get in the message. Father, I'm thankful tonight that I have the privilege of opening Your Word. But God, even if I didn't have this privilege tonight, I'm thankful for who You are. I'm thankful for the relationship I am privileged to have in You. God, You know how wide the rivers get. You know how high the mountains get. But we want to affirm our trust in You. We want to rejoice in who You are. We want to look above and beyond our circumstances and just dig in spiritual roots very deep. We want to be established. We want to be renewed. We need so desperately to be revived. Help us to have that. I pray tonight as we go to Your Word, I pray that we'd find security in it. I pray that we'd find understanding in it. I pray we'd find a desire to tenaciously hold on to it. For it's Your Word that gives us hope, You say in the Psalms. Help us now, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you turn to the last book in your Bible, the book of Revelation, please? Chapter number 20. I mentioned this morning that I'm going to deal with spiritual warfare. I believe that as believers, we're in the thick of spiritual warfare. I believe whether you work at a school or whether you work at a factory or whether you're an engineer somewhere or whether you're in the political arena or whether you work in a church or whatever it is you do, I believe there's a resistance. I believe there's a spiritual warfare that wars against us. Now I want you to look in Revelation with me tonight, Revelation chapter number 20. And I'm going to start there in, let me just start verse number 1. The Bible says this, "And I saw an angel come down from heaven having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, the old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. What a day. And cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years should be fulfilled." Drop down there to the latter part of verse number 4. And it says, "And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. We refer to this the millennial reign of Christ. As we look in prophecy, as we look forward in the prophetical calendar, we know before us there is a rapture. We know before us there's a tribulation period. We know at the end of the tribulation period, it's going to conclude with a very bad battle, the Battle of Armageddon. That's not the final battle, but a very bad battle. There's the Battle of Armageddon, and then that ushers in, the Battle of Armageddon ushers in the millennial reign of Christ. That is a 1,000-year period where Satan is bound and cast into the holding, if you please. And if you look in the preceding chapter, this in chapter 19, you'll look there in verse number 15. "And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, and it should be that it should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron." It's a reference to the millennial reign of Christ. that 1,000-year period, where Jesus shall rule with a rod of iron. Now, people have tried to describe that, what it's going to be like. You do wrong, and he's going to take a rod and hit you on the head. That's not what it's referring to. The idea is a strong rule. It will come to pass. Right now, you war in the flesh. Should I do right or should I do wrong? During the millennial reign of Christ, the rule of Christ is done. And that resistance you talked in your Sunday school hour, that flesh that wants to do wrong, that's the enemy, that's Satan. Well, you take that out of the picture. He's now bound. And so for 1,000 years, humanity will be in a state of peace. The world will be in a state of peace. Matter of fact, if you'll turn over there to the book of Isaiah, please. There's a few scriptures in Isaiah refer to it. I'm just going to pick out this one, Isaiah chapter number 11. Let me hasten to say this as I get moving here. I'll probably go a lot of scriptures, catch what you can, write what you can, whatever. Pick up on the next one if I pass by, because there's a lot of scripture here. Isaiah chapter number 11. Let me just jump down to verse number 6. This is a description. This is a description of the millennial reign of Christ. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid. The calf and the young lion and the fatling together, and the little child shall lead them. This is the idea. This is the idea that on this earth, there will be a time, that is the millennial reign of Christ, but there will be a time where the lamb and the lion shall lay down together. Verse number 8, and the suckling child shall play on the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the cockatrice den. In other words, this is a time of absolute peace on the earth. So the question comes, why does it have to be future? Why can't it be now? There is one element that keeps us from having it now. That's Satan. You see, the only reason why during the millennial reign of Christ that there's peace is because the enemy is bound. He's not at liberty to war against the believer. So therefore, what I want to talk about tonight is I want to talk about that warfare that you and I face. That warfare of the enemy. Now, unless I fail to say it somewhere else, I need to make it clear here. Excuse me. Satan is one individual. I won't get into all the background of where he came from and all that, but I need you to understand, Satan is not God. God is omnipresent. That means he's everywhere at all times. Satan is not that way. Satan can only be one place at one time. Usually we talk about Satan doing this or Satan doing that or the devil doing that or the devil doing this. In all reality, it's probably not specifically Satan or the devil, but rather his kingdom, the demons, the devils that war. Hope to come back and catch that, but I don't want to mislead you to think that the devil is everywhere at all times. He's not, but his kingdom is. So I want to read some scripture as we begin to go into this thing here in Ephesians, please. Ephesians chapter number 6, verse number 10. The Bible says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. And that's my admonition tonight to you. It's not about your physical strength. It's not about your mental prowess. It's about having strength in God. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord, in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God. Why? That you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. If you don't have the power of God on your life, you will fall prey to the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. We war in a spiritual battle. How about 1 Timothy chapter number 1? 1 Timothy chapter number 1, verse number 18. This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before thee, that thou mightest war a good warfare. You and I tonight are involved in a warfare. We are up against spiritual wickedness. We're up against a spiritual enemy. How about 2 Corinthians chapter number 10? 2 Corinthians chapter number 10, verse number 4 says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal." The weapons of our warfare, we are in a war. Which brings me to my first point, the reality of this war. I can't stress enough that we are in a spiritual battle. There are spiritual forces that do try to oppose us, that do try to work against us, that do try to destroy us. I'm reminded about one time I was in a Sunday school class, visiting church in a Sunday school class, and this subject came up about demons and about devils and about possession and about inhabiting and oppression, these type things up. And she said, this lady had been saved for a number of years, elderly lady at the time. She said, "Well, I know things like that happen around the world, but they don't happen in our town." There's not a place that they do not happen. If humanity is there, there's a warfare that goes on. Would you turn to Luke, please? Luke's Gospel, chapter number 11. In Luke's Gospel, chapter number 11, Jesus speaking here. Verse number 14. "And he was casting out a devil, and it was dumb. And it came to pass, when the devil was gone out and the dumb spake, that the people wondered. But some of them said," he "casteth out devils through Beelzebub, the chief of the devils. And others, tempting him, sought of him a sign from heaven. But he, knowing their thoughts, said on them, Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and a house divided against a house falleth. If Satan also be divided against himself, how shall his kingdom stand?" Jesus acknowledged not only the working of Satan, but also that he has a kingdom, a spiritual empowerment, a spiritual group of wickedness, a group of spiritual warriors. I'm reminded of Matthew chapter number 4, verse number 11. This is the temptation of Christ. I want you to see something here. In chapter number 4, verse number 1, says, "Then was Jesus led up in the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil." And there were three specific temptations, but I want you to look down there in verse number 11. After he had been through the temptations, after he had conquered these temptations, I want you to see something very important. Verse 11 says, "Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, the angels came and ministered unto him." Why? Why would the angels come minister unto him? Because something about the warfare took something out of him. Now keep in mind, at this point, he was 100% God, yet he was 100% man. And the life he was living in the flesh, he was living it by the flesh, okay? And so what he was conquering in the flesh. Of course, by the power of God, we understand that. So when the spiritual battle takes place, it physically wears them down. I'm reminded of years ago, when I was in Bible college, we would have visitation, and the visitation director would pass out these cards. Said they would get partners together, and they'd pass out cards. So I had a visitation partner of mine that we went to college together, friends, and so they passed us out this card, and this place that we were supposed to go was Zellers. It's a lot like Whitfield in Jackson. And so we had never been there before, and so we took the card, we went to the address, come to this very large complex, but there was no entry place. I mean, there was a way to get in, but there's nothing that says entrance. There was no specific thing that just kind of set anything outside as entrance. So we drove all around the building and found several doors going in, but didn't find an entry door. I said, just pull in there, we'll find out where we're supposed to go. So we go in this place, and just open this door. There's a hallway there, and we see a gentleman that has keys. So we think, well, hey, we're trying to get to such this place here. Could you help us out? Yeah, come with me. So we followed him. Everything seemed to be fine. And we go in this elevator, and we get in the elevator. He goes, I'm thinking, okay, backed up. The doors open on the floor we want to do. Doors open up, he goes, boom, he's gone city. That was my introduction. That was my introduction to Zellers. Well, because we had went there once before, every other time they had a call, it was us. We become the residential visitors. And I remember one time, they give us a call to go. And we had been up in this particular part. It's where you go in, and they have to unlock the door for you to go in and lock the door behind you. I ain't crazy about stuff like that. Besides, the people locking the door, they're not paying attention to what's going on in the first place. So we go in there. We've been in there before. We know the people that's in there. We've talked with them. And so now we're in there, and they taught us in school that you have a two go out, and one does the talking, the other one doesn't talk, but sits there and prays and just asks God to work and asks God to save that soul. So it's my friend's turn to talk. But he was on fire. Well, he's talking to this girl, letting her have, man. He's giving her the gospel, and man, it was just flowing out of him. And I'm praying, and he's preaching, and I'm praying, and I kind of stopped, and I was looking around, and she says in the midst of this, when I'm starting to become aware of my surroundings, she just stops and says, I killed my baby. Everybody in this room is in here because they killed somebody. My friend, he didn't check up. He was preaching away. Giving her the gospel. And I'm looking around, and I noticed something very interesting. Men and women both in this line here. And I noticed they're walking around us. The whole group walking around us. Now, I'm not a fighter. I'm not a brawler, but I have my hands clenched up. They touch me, I'm going out the wall. I'm feeling it. I'm feeling the walls closing in. I am feeling the spiritual warfare of this place. My friend, he has not checked up. He's given the gospel. He believes he can get saved. I finally got his attention. It was an odd moment. He quickly came to the end of that gospel presentation. And we got up and excused us out of there. I can't put into words the feeling of evil. Not just bad, but evil. There was another occasion, I have several stories at that place, there was another occasion we were called to go there. And I remember after making our call, we are going out of the facility. Like I said, it's a very large facility. We're going out of the facility. And then as we were walking out, I was having a very difficult time making a step. I mean, I was pushing against, it was terrible. I explained this to my friend. I said, I can't hardly walk. It was just like something was against me here. I said, don't let anybody touch me. If you have to, you drag me out of this place. And we got out of there, and the moment I got out, I was fine. I'm not trying to give you the heebie-jeebies. I'm not trying to talk about sensationalism. I'm just telling you there's a reality out there that we overlook. We hide in our little Christian glass houses. And we fail to realize that we are indeed in a warfare. And there's an enemy out there that's trying to destroy. The verse I read this morning, or quoted this morning. That he come to give life. But hey, the devil does not come to give life. He comes to destroy. He comes to kill. He comes to ruin whatever life you have in you. There is a warfare that we're against. So someone comes up with a question, where do we war? I'm going to list some things here, but I would just say, where do we not war? But there does seem to be some places that seem to gravitate, to seem to have a greater influence in warfare. Politics and government, and I mean no ill by any of these things I'm saying, simply because in the midst of that, there's a lot of glory, honor, power, greed, and control. Therefore, it's an environment that the evil spirits, that the devils like to work in. There's the business world. You know the verse in Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse number 10. For the love of money is the root of all evil. It's not money that's evil. It's the love for it. And in the business world, greed and lust and covetousness seems to take a strong play in that. And when we do the works of the flesh, as you referred to in the Sunday school, we do the works of the flesh, that seems to be a habitation which the evil spirits like to work in. There's the entertainment and pleasure centers. Because all this sensuality just comes into play alongside of it. There's unclean places. Obviously, unclean spirits like to inhabit unclean places. Hey, here's another one. How about religion? Would you go to 2 Corinthians, please? 2 Corinthians chapter number 11. 2 Corinthians, I mean 1 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter number 11 and verse number 13. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. They're not apostles of Christ, but they're posing as. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. You mentioned this morning, again in your Sunday school hour, you mentioned this morning about the progression in church. It used to be when you went to a Baptist church, you know what you were going to get. You knew there would be a man of God that stood up in the pulpit of God and preached the Word of God. You knew that's what you were going to get. Like it or didn't like it, that's what he was going to give you. The Word of God. It's not that way everywhere, is it anymore? Now, as you mentioned about the feel-good stuff, and I want to feel good, I do. And I want the Word of God to encourage me and enrich me and give me life. But it's not always about me, is it? I'm not the hero of the church, am I? You're not the hero of the church, are you? Jesus Christ is the head of the church. He needs to be the one promoted. Not a leader or a group of leaders or individuals. It's the Lord that's supposed to be the anointed one, the lifted up, the high one. You go to the book of Revelation, chapter number 3, there's chapter number 2 and chapter number 3, there's a listing of seven churches. We call them the seven churches of Asia Minor. Seven literal physical churches. But I believe each one of those churches represent a church age in progression. The last church is the church of Laodicea. And there's an interesting thing about the church. They gather together. They meet. They have service. But someone's knocking on the outside. What does that tell you? They're not on the inside. And it's the Lord knocking, trying to get in and sup with His people. And I believe that's the state in which we're going. We've got our buildings and we've got our programs, but we don't have God. Amen. Talks about Satan transforming him into an angel of light. How do these demons, devils, how do they work? How do they war? There are two basic ways in Scripture in which they war. There is demon possession, and there is demon oppression. Demon possession is from on the inside. Demon oppression is from the outside. Would you go to Mark, please? Mark chapter number 5. In Mark chapter number 5, probably the greatest dramatical story, historical record of an individual that was inhabited by demons. And probably one of the greatest transformations recorded in the Bible. The Bible says in Mark chapter number 5, tells us where he goes in verse number 1. Verse number 2 says, "And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man that had with an unclean spirit, who had his dwellings among the tombs. No man could bind him, no, not with chains." What would happen every time they grabbed this guy and put chains about him? He broke free. Demons inhabiting humanity empowers them. Stories have been told about their great strengths. Here's one such story. Because he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broke in pieces, neither could any man tame him. He's a wild man, untamable. Always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs crying and cutting himself. That's a popular thing people are doing these days, cuttings. See the root of it right here. There's a list of things what he does. Verse number 9, "And he asked him, what is thy name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many." Many devils inhabited this individual. "And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country." That's the demons are speaking here. "Now there was there nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding. And all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter into them. And forthwith Jesus gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea, and there was about 2,000. This is the habitation of devils in an individual. Probably the most dramatic story written in the Bible. Nonetheless, it's true. Let me just kind of list off some things in the Bible that happens when people are demon-possessed. That is, a devil is inside of them. Matthew chapter number 9, they cause dumbness, can't speak. Matthew chapter number 12, they cause blindness. Luke chapter number 13, they cause deformity. Mark chapter number 9, some sort of epileptic fit. Luke chapter number 8, some sort of insanity. Mark chapter number 9, suicidal mania. Mark chapter number 5, the one we talked about there, where he tried to injure himself. 2 Corinthians talks about how they cause them to be false preachers and false teachers. That's demon possession. That is where the devil or the devils inhabit a man or a woman or an individual and work from the inside out. There's also demon oppression. That is where the devils work on the outside and work on the individual. King Saul would probably be a good illustration of that. How an evil spirit came upon him. Did not enter in him, but came upon him. In 2 Corinthians chapter number 12, verse number 7, Paul talked about a physical illness that he had, as a result of the messenger of Satan. In Acts chapter number 19, verse number 13 through 16, there's the sons of Sceva and how the demons jumped upon them and they begin to gnash. They can cause emotional problems like depression, weariness, wrath, anger, apathy, confusion, doubts, and etc. But here's the question. People said, can a Christian be demon-possessed? Well, hang with me. There is not a verse in the Bible that says you cannot be demon-possessed. Just hang with me. Let me finish my thought. I know Baptist preachers that believe that a Christian can be inhabited by demons. I was told by an individual that he cast out of a demon out of a believer. I'm just telling you what he said. Let me hasten to say there's not a scripture that says you cannot be inhabited by a demon. However, there's no Bible illustration showing us that anybody that was saved ever was inhabited. Not one. Let me show you some verses. 1 Corinthians chapter number 3. 1 Corinthians chapter number 3. Verse number 16. Know you not that you are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If you're a child of God, my Bible says that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Don't say it doesn't say you have multiple spirits. It said God's Spirit dwells in you. Would you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 15? In 2 Corinthians, they were talking about this text here. Paul was talking about the separation between the unbeliever and the believer. But in the midst of this, in chapter number 6, verse number 15, he says, what concord has Christ with Belial? In other words, the idea is musical harmony. In other words, you can't have it in the same habitation or place. It doesn't work. How about 1 John chapter 4? Again, who dwells in us as a child of God? Whose Spirit dwells in us? Help me out. The Holy Spirit, God dwells within us if we're believers. So the Bible says in 1 John chapter number 4, 1 John chapter number 4, verse number 4, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. I believe, based on the understanding of the scriptures, that I know that a child of God cannot be inhabited by demons. I do not believe a child of God can be possessed by a demon. Why? Because the Spirit of God lives within inside of us. However, we can be oppressed. The story I told you there at Zellers, I tried to walk out of that building. I believe that was spiritual oppression. I believe that was a spiritual enemy trying to resist. You ever had doubts? You ever had moments of depression? Where's this coming from? I believe that spiritual oppression from the outside working in on us. No, he cannot take up habitation in me because the Spirit of God is already there. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world outside of me. But he can oppose. He can work against us. Would you turn to Mark, please? Mark chapter number 3. Mark chapter number 3. Mark chapter number 3 and verse number 24. And if a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If it was possible for the evil elements, for the devils and demons to be inside of us, that kingdom would have to be a divided kingdom. And it can't stand. I don't believe that you can, as a child of God, can be demon-possessed. But I do believe there's spiritual warfare all about us. And no, they cannot have your soul, but they can sure make your life miserable. Now, there's a lot more things that I would like to say. My time's escaping from me. Let me bring this all back to something here. What our weapons are not, they are not carnal according to 2 Corinthians chapter number 10. You can't do bodybuilding, running, crossfitting, etc. It won't work. It's not political correctness, learning to speak flowerly and correctly. Paul talked about it, it didn't come with you with enticing words. It's not as James talked about it, it's not with man's wisdom. It's not with religious trinkets and relics. There's nowhere in the Word of God where they put up crosses or listen to Christian music to keep out the evil habitations. It's not in there. There was one time where they put the handkerchief, I believe, of Paul on another one and they were healed. But it did not ward off. There's not a trinket. You can't wear a cross. You can't have a spike to ward off evil spirits. So let me deal with our method of warfare and I'm going to be done here. How actually do you and I fight against this warfare? I remember years ago I pastored in Magnolia, Mississippi, Tabernacle Baptist Church. Before I went there, the church went through an awful split. And I remember someone telling me about how a member of the church, large individual, grabbed the pastor by the collar and threatened him. Right there in the church. You do understand that our warfare is not us. Now, I can't help that sometimes we'll differ. I can't help sometimes we'll be on absolute ends of the spectrum. But we're not the enemy. Oftentimes in homes, the husbands and wives become locked in a battle. But they're not the enemy. There's a warfare that's going on. We fight not against flesh and blood. It's the principalities. It's the spiritual wickedness we fight against. So how are you and I, what method will we use to overcome those forces that work against us? I've listed four things here. First of all, assuming we're saved, okay? I'm just assumption is everybody's saved, okay? As believers, how are we going to warfare? The first thing and foremost thing we got to do is we have to claim our redemptive rights. Amen. It's not about me. I am a child of God. I've been adopted. I have full right to the family through adoption. Greater is he that is in me than he's in the world. And when the enemy comes to oppose, we need to claim our redemptive rights by God's power, by God's help, by God's grace. In a church situation, and it becomes an abrupt situation, don't rise up, fall down to our knees. We don't need more of this. We need more of this. As a believer, there is great power at our disposal. But it's not in my brain. Not in my brawn. It's in my God. Philippians says, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. My power as a believer is in Jesus Christ. The second thing is I'm to put on the whole armor of God. In Ephesians, we were there a moment ago, Ephesians chapter number 6, where it brought us an introduction to the spiritual warfare. In chapter 6, it goes on further and says, it says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. It talks about, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, as I mentioned earlier. And then in verse number 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, and I believe 18, it gives us the armament, the armor that we put on as believers. your loins girt about with truth. Always be honest. Breastplate of righteousness, always before you do right. Your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Walk in peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith that is before you, believing and focus on the living God of heaven, the helmet of salvation. That is not putting on salvation. It's the fact that I know that I know that I know that I'm a child of God. Not facing these things in doubts, but in security. Ephesians, while we're here, chapter number 4, verse number 27. Maintain strict control. In chapter number 4, verse number 27, says, neither give place to the devil. And I'm afraid so often in our life, the reason why our warfare sometimes is so great is because we gave entry point to the devil. That's why habits and addictions are so bad. All it takes is just one entry point, and in comes the enemy. Our responsibility as a believer is to bring our body in subjection. In other words, as Paul says, I die daily. I die to Carl daily and I live to him. As a believer, my responsibility is always to choose right. Do I always choose right? No. I wish I did. But if I'm going to overcome, I've got to choose right, not wrong. I have to take responsibility for what I do, where I go, what I say, what I feel. I need to exercise vigilance. Would you go back to Corinthians, please? 2 Corinthians chapter number 2. 2 Corinthians chapter number 2. Verse number 11. Lest Satan get advantage of us. Be sober. Be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, seeketh who he may devour. Don't ever put it on cruise. Don't ever kick it up into neutral. Always stay vigilant. Always be on your guard. Every time I think about that verse, I think about the boxing ring. Could you imagine how detrimental it would be if a boxer was in a ring, a heavyweight boxer was in the ring, they're sparring back and forth, and just for a moment he takes his hands down and looks the other way, it'd be lights out at best. And I believe for believers it's the same thing. We can't ever stop being vigilant, cautious, watching. Hey, you got a good church here. You got a good group of people. Don't ever take your finger off the pulse. Like that, it's gone. One of the reasons why you have a good church here is because I believe there's good families here. Don't ever take your finger off the pulse, because it's like that, it's gone. Always be vigilant. Always be on top of it. Always be careful. Always be watching. Then James says, in James chapter number 4. It says, submit yourselves therefore to God and resist the devil. You and I have to resist some things. There are things out in this world that sound good, but they're not of God. Resist it. There are some things out in this world that look good, but they're not of God. Resist it. There are some things out in the world that taste good, smell good, have an appeal to us, but they're not of God. Resist it. Would you go to 1 Corinthians, please, as I try to wind this up, chapter 15. My last verse. There's coming a day where Satan will be bound for 1,000 years. There'll be 1,000-year reign of Christ where there'll be absolute peace on this earth. But that's future. That's not now. Now the Bible says in Revelation chapter 12, verse number 12, that he knows his days are limited. He knows his time is short. That's why we're seeing some things heat up. That's why we're seeing a lot more aggression. Things we never would even have thought about. Making way for the Antichrist to step on the scene. You don't have this daylight to dark overnight. It's a slow, gradual thing. But as it gets closer, the picks up momentum. That's where we're at now. We have an enemy. And our responsibility is to stay focused. Paul said this of his faith. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I want to be able to say that, don't you, sister? I want to say when it comes to the end, I didn't quit. I didn't give in. I stuck with it. I stayed at it. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know your labor is not in vain in the Lord. May I remind you, it's not about me or you. It's about Him. It's about in the Lord. Now, our focus does not need to be on a presidential race. Our focus does not need to be on the next raise or the next purchase we want to buy. Though I do believe these things are all a part of life. But our focus needs to be on the living God of heaven. Because there's a warfare about us. There's an enemy that's trying to destroy. I'm tired of him winning. I want to see the victory. I want to see God's people not cower down to it. I want to see God's people rise up. I think we passed by a sign on the way back from lunch that said, enough is enough. Don't you agree? Amen. Enough is enough. It's time for us to stand up. It's time for us to get at it and go with it and oppose it. It's time for the Lord to work in our life. We need to resist that one that fights against us. Would you stand your feet, please? I know I've gone long. We'll have our invitational hymn here. I don't know exactly what the Lord is wanting to do in your life, but I do know this. There's a spirit of understanding that I felt tonight. I felt like that tonight people understood what I'm talking about when I'm talking about this warfare. And we understand we have a responsibility in it. Now what we're going to do? Give in or get up. Give in or get up. Let's pray. Father, I would ask in the name of Jesus Christ that you would grant courage here tonight. God, the enemy is coming in like a flood. Help us as your church, as your believers, as your children, to rise up and allow you to work in our life. May you be the hope we look to and anticipate. Help us now to have your countenance shine upon us, that our countenance may reflect who you are in our life. May you put a hedge upon this church. May you put a hedge upon the families of this church. I pray that the enemies would not be able to come in and destroy and to rob and to take. But God, that these people would look to you and would trust you, and you'd have great victory here at this place among these people's lives. Help us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. With our heads bowed, our eyes closed.